today we are going to be speaking about the Soham murders. So these occurred in Cambridgeshire in August 2002. They involved Jessica Chapman and Holly Wells. They were both 10 years old at the time. They both lived in Soham and they were both Manchester United fans. They were attending a barbecue at the Wells' premises. Ian Huntley, he was a caretaker at the college. His partner, Maxine Carr, she was a teaching assistant at the school. Huntley was involved with younger girls. He had been accused of rape by three underage girls. He was charged with burglary of a neighbour in Grimsby. And the burglary was on the police records, however, the rapes were not. The girls went to buy sweets at 6:15 p.m. and they did not return. The parents realised that they were missing at 8:30 p.m. and the panic started. They formed a search party with family and friends and Huntley joined in the search party. So when the girls went to buy sweets, Huntley approached the girls and invited them in. He said that Maxine Carr was inside and wanted to speak to them about school, but Carr was actually visiting family in Grimsby. Huntley killed Holly Wells first through drowning. He said that she had a nosebleed in the police report and said that he was trying to help her clean it up when she tripped and drowned in the bath. Jessica was screaming for help when Holly was dead. She tried to call her mother, who didn't pick up. Huntley smothered her, and he said to the police in his interview, he put his hand on her shoulder when she tried to run for the door and realised that he couldn't let her leave. Jessica's mobile was switched off at 6:45 p.m, so it's assumed that they were dead at this point. Huntley called Maxine Carr, his partner, on the same night of the murders. He claims that he wanted to confess, but Carr told him not to because she didn't want to lose a job. Huntley drove 20 miles with the bodies and dumped the girls in a ditch. Huntley left Jessica's phone on the draining board and the police were doing door-to-door checks and didn't see the phone. Huntley quickly disposed of it in a bin at a local supermarket, and the phone has still never been found to this day. He returned to the bodies where he dumped them later on and set them alight. He did this to dispose of forensic evidence. Huntley helped with press and TV interviews and pleas to try and get the girls to come home, and the police became suspicious because he was too emotionally involved, even though they weren't his children. The bodies were found on August 17th, 2002. DNA testing was needed to identify the bodies as they were unrecognisable from the ignition. The police took Huntley and Carr in for questioning. Carr gave Huntley an alibi. As the police were questioning Huntley and Carr, they found major evidence, which was the Man United shirts found charred at the college, which was the shirts that they were wearing just before they went out to buy sweets. Huntley and Carr were arrested on suspicion of murder over the shirts. The bodies were found shortly after the shirts were discovered and the bodies were in bad condition. They couldn't determine sexual assault, but in the court, the judge ruled that the crime was committed with sexual intent. Hairs and fibres linked Huntley to the crime, even though he had tried to dispose of the forensic evidence through ignition. Carr was sentenced to 3.5 years in prison for perverting the cause of justice, and Huntley was sectioned under the Mental Health Act and he was deemed fit to stand trial by a psychiatrist. He tried to convince the psychiatrist that he wasn't fit to stand trial and that he was mentally ill. However, the psychiatrist saw through this and said he was mentally and physically sound at the time of the murders and for trial. He was sentenced to 40 years imprisonment. In 2003, he was attacked with boiling water by another inmate whilst in prison, and he gained treatment for this. And then after this, he tried to overdose on 29 antidepressants. Then again, he tried to overdose in 2005 and got treatment and was taken back to prison. And another inmate slit his throat in 2010. However, he did get stitches and treatment and he did survive this as well. In early 2018, so quite recently, Huntley has claimed that he wants to be a woman. However, this is under scrutiny and it's being debated due to the nature of his crime, as they believe that he's saying this just so that he can get into a female prison. He is currently receiving support to help him determine if he does want to transition into a woman, and the prison are providing counselling for him at present. In 2010, Carr was given a new identity when upon release under the premise of life endangerment. In 2010, she had a child with her new husband. It was deemed that police checks were not thorough enough on Huntley, as they didn't keep the rapes on the police files, and that's why he was able to get a job at a college with children. Obviously, if they'd put that on the police files and they'd done background checks officially, they wouldn't have allowed him to work there. That's why CRB checks are now tighter with new loopholes, so that any crimes can be seen by an employer, even driving offences, when working with vulnerable people and children. And that's all for today, guys. I will leave information in the description if you want to review this case yourself. It was just a quick one, and I hope you found it interesting. Thanks.